I'm going to ask you to go back into time, and I'm going to just say a number, and just go back into time and remember where you were and what was happening. Okay, and just think about it for a minute. Okay, about when you were about 17, 18 years old. So just flashback. Go back to where you were. Now, there are a lot of transitions in our life, but about that time, there's some amazing big transitions that are happening right there where you are now being asked to become an adult. All of a sudden, the decisions you make right then are going to launch you into the real world. So far, you've been growing up, and mom and dad have been taking care of everything. And, you know, not, I'm just saying, you know, a typical family setting. And then all of a sudden, right now, at about 17, 18, you're being launched into a whole new world. Some of you're going off to college, whole new world, whole net of circumstances. Mom and dad wouldn't be there to hold your hand or to scold you for staying out late. Some of you were drafted into the military. Some of you were choosing to go in. That whole new world, all of a sudden you're leaving home and it's a whole new, everything is changing right at about that time. So you're being asked to step up. You're being asked to step into a place for a lot of you that you'd never been before, a new uncharted ground. Well, we're going to look in the Old Testament at one that the Bible picks up, and it doesn't say much about his life until he's 17. And it's almost like at that time, the Lord just started to dial into this young man, still a youth, really, that a change was beginning to happen and that God was going to use him in an amazing way. And he probably didn't even know it yet. But at that time, right about that time, it started to happen, about age 17. So we're going to be talking about Joseph of the in the Old Testament, chapter 37 of Genesis. And we're going to go through verses 1 through 11. And what we're going to be seeing in this is that Genesis, first book of the Bible, chapter 37. And we're going to see that Joseph lives for what is true. He lives for what is true, and he may not understand it yet, but he's made some decisions to live for what is true. And what we're going to see is that there was an amazing love that his father had for him, that it looks like that's what motivated him to live for what is true or live for what his dad had told him to do. And so with that, what we're going to do is we're going to look at Joseph's life at about age 17. So we're going to take a snapshot of that. And then we're going to see some similarities between Jesus Christ. Now, it looks like Joseph did all of the right moves. What's beautiful about reading his story, as most of you have done, is that we see before then that his father and his father before that, they didn't always do everything right, but it looks like Joseph is doing everything right. It's like, I want to be like Joseph. And so we're going to see Joseph's life, and then we're going to see just some similarities between Jesus Christ and then what the Lord is calling us to. What do you and I need to see and hear and follow and believe? So let me just thank the Lord again. Father, we bless your name and we thank you for pulling us together. Lord, we understand that for most of us, 17 was a long time ago. But you have had us on a journey. You have been training us to live what is true. You've been training us to follow you. You are the author of life. You are the truth. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except by you, Jesus. So, Lord, we thank you. So we recognize that you've called us, you've pulled us together on our journey at this time to intersect right here at this building right now. And we're asking that you will instruct us and motivate us and strengthen us to follow you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so as we go through this, what I began to find was four sections in here. And what I'd like to do is, if you're taking notes, take your paper and maybe on the back, down the left side, write these letters that spell out true and space them on. There's four sections, and it looks like just some things about living what is true. So mark T-R-U-E, and those will be our four sections as we step through this. So kind of a cross stick. And so I'm going to use different words that come out horizontally just to keep us focused on Joseph's life and these four things. Okay, so the story picks up Genesis chapter 37. It says, now Jacob lived in the land where his father had sojourned, in the land of Canaan. And these are the records of the generations of Jacob. So Jacob is his dad, and God actually renamed him Israel. And out of Jacob's sons will come the 12 tribes of Israel. So just a little background there. So it says during this time or this generation, here's where he lived, and these are the records. And then it starts out. So this is your first letter is T, and we're going to put time there. Just like I started talking in the introduction about that time when you were 17. Well, right here, it shoots us back to when Joseph was 17. So that just in verse 2 there it says, these are the records of the generations of Jacob. Joseph, when 17 years of age, this is what he was doing. He was pasturing the flock with his brothers while he was still a youth. Now, hold on to that for a minute. He's 17, and it says he's still a youth. So here he is, this child, he's growing up, he's 17, and maybe for many of you, at 17, you look like you were grown up. You look like you were an adult, but you're still a little boy, a little girl inside. You're going, wow, this is all new. So I thought that was interesting. He's 17, and it says he was still a youth. So he's pasturing a flock, and it says, along with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. Okay, stop there for a minute. So, if you didn't know already, Jacob married four women. The love of his life was Rachel, and his father-in-law tricked him into marrying the older sister, Leah. So, within a week, he had two wives. He tricked him, and he ended up marrying Leah, and a week later he says, okay, I'm sorry. You know, a week later, you can have Rachel. Rachel was the love of his life. Anyways, these women were wanting to be first place in Jacob's life, and so there was this struggle over who would have the most children, and whoever had the most children, it seemed like a game, whoever had the most children, that's who Jacob would love the most. And so there was this competition that went out. And it didn't even stop there. There were two maids, Bilhah, who was Leah's maid, and Zilpah, who was Rachel's maid, in this war of who was going to have more children. They said, well, Leah said, I stopped producing, so I want you to take my maid and give her as a wife, and she's going to produce. And so she produced too. And so, well, Rachel was the first one to do that because Rachel was barren. Rachel didn't have any children. And so Rachel did that with her maid first. And so we now, Jacob ends up with four wives, and it's a race to see who has the most children. And Rachel, the love of his life, is barren. So the reason why I say all that is he's pasturing the flock with these brothers that I guess would be stepbrothers, that not from the same mother. But Joseph was a special child in the sense that after 20-some years, Rachel, the Bible says that God opened Rachel's womb and Joseph was born. So now you can see how special Joseph was to Jacob, that from the love of his life, after 20 years, she gave birth the firstborn that she had. That was Joseph. Okay? Special child. Now, during this time, she, right away, she wanted another child, and she pleaded when she gave birth to Joseph that she would have another child. The second child does. She does get pregnant. During the birth of Benjamin, her second child, she dies. So at this point in time, Rachel has been buried. She's, the love of his life is gone, but Joseph, we're talking about Joseph right here. So from that birth of Joseph, there's not much said about him, hardly anything at all. All of a sudden, right at this time, and that's why I say time, God starts to dial in a plan for Joseph. Okay, so Joseph is out taking care of the sheep with his brothers, and it says, and Joseph brought back a bad report about his brothers to their father. Okay, so Joseph is the second to the youngest in the family. So he's kind of like the baby in the family. And he's out there and he comes home and he tattles on his brothers because they were not doing something that they were supposed to do that dad had instructed them. So there's a little resentment there. There's something going on there. That little brother, they figured he shouldn't have told on them. Now, little brother is just living the truth. He knows what dad expects, and so he just, it looks like he's not out to be mean to his brothers. It's just that there was something bad going on. It doesn't say what it was, but he comes back and he says, hey, dad, this is what the brothers were doing. He brought back a bad report. Then in verse 3, we see something that begins to happen here. And it says, now Israel loved Joseph more than all his sons because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a very colored tunic. Okay. So not only did little brother bring back a bad report, but little brother was the favorite of his father. They all knew that, but dad even showed that more by he had a special coat that he had made for him. Okay. So as we look at Joseph's life, and so far, here's this young man, this youth, and he's just speaking the truth. He's doing what he's supposed to do. He's speaking the truth. He brings it back to dad. He knows he's loved by dad. Now I don't think that Joseph was out to win a popularity contest when he did that. He was just doing what he was supposed to do, the truth. Transfer that to Jesus. I don't think Jesus, when he began his ministry, he was out to win a popularity contest. And the reason why I say that, in Matthew, the first words that Jesus said is, you are wrong, change your ways and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is here. Now, I don't know anybody that would win a popularity contest by pointing to people and saying, you're living wrong, change your ways, and live for God. That wouldn't go very far, would it? Okay, so he's not out. But the interesting thing is that when he says repent, here is God in the flesh. He's instructing his creation to live what is true and right. Now, the Pharisees especially, did not see that as love. the brothers did not see Joseph speaking truth as love. They saw it as even meanness or hate or whatever little brother was doing. They were jealous of little brother, but they didn't see it as love. You and I, oftentimes, when somebody goes to correct us, we don't feel the love, do we? We don't feel the love when they say, you know what, you might consider not doing that. I don't think that's God's way. And we go something like, who do you think you are? You have your, you know, all of a sudden, there's an attack going on and we don't see that it really is love when somebody's trying to help us to follow God. But it's hard to do, isn't it? Because we know our reaction and we know other people's reaction that can happen when we're trying to say, hey, this isn't right. Let's follow God together, okay? All right, so Jesus wasn't out to win a popularity contest. They didn't see it as love when he said repent. Joseph's brothers didn't see that. But there was something here that they knew, that Joseph held a special place with his dad. There was an amazing love there, and there was no doubt that it happened, that it was happening. I've got a question for you. How do you function and behave when you know that there is someone that loves you no matter what? Maybe it's your husband or your wife. Maybe they are the ones that go, you know, they know all my areas, and you know what? They still love me. So I ask that question to go, what motivates you when you know that there's an amazing love that someone has for you? Transferring that to Jesus, do you remember the scene when Jesus was baptized? It says that the Father spoke from heaven. And he said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Is that an amazing thought to think? Jesus is beginning his public ministry, and his Father, his booming voice, in a sense, wraps his arms around his son Jesus, and he says, I love you. I am so pleased with you. What you're about to do, I just love you. And I couldn't help but to think that when we settle on how much God loves you and me, that from that place, everything ought to pivot. When you know that God loves you so much, and he displayed that by sending his son to die on the cross for you so that you could have a relationship with God the Almighty, and that he would prove his power over sin and death by coming back to life. That kind of love. It's amazing to see when children know that they are loved. There's a confidence that rings out in them when they play and when they have this background of a mom and dad that love them so much, that's always caring for them. And it's amazing how those children operate. They're just confident and they're just going. They believe everything mom and dad have said and their instruction and they're just receiving. But their background is coming from an amazing kind of love that they know. They know that mom and dad just love them intensely, and their actions and the things that they're doing. There are studies done that talk about infants, and when infants are cuddled and taken care of, they thrive and they grow. And when infants are just left by themselves, they actually wither and they begin to die. It's amazing. So I don't know where you have come from. Maybe you didn't have that perfect dad and mom. Maybe you didn't come from that. But since you, if you have trusted in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, He has been the door that opens you to God. And the Bible says that God is love. And the first thing that happens is that you begin to renew your mind on this God that loves you, and your identity begins to be built in all that is right and true. And you begin to make decisions based on a God that so loves you that He will never leave you. I believe that when we renew our minds on what is true and right, our decisions and things that we do begins to affect people around us with that same kind of love. My father loved me. One of the coolest memories I have with my dad, and he wasn't the perfect father, but there was a time when I was about, I don't know, 10 or 12 when I came to about here on him, and he's the same height that I am right now, so I'm just guessing. And I remember it was one of the times that I got hurt or somebody hurt me or something, and I remember coming to my dad, and there was that, I don't know why that time, but he just simply, when I came to him, he simply opened his arms and he took my head and he just pulled me close to his chest. And I don't remember him saying anything, but there was something about that that just said, my dad loves me. My dad cares for me. And that's a powerful image of God for you and I, that we land on this truth that God loves you so much. He wanted you in His family so much that He sent His Son to die for you so that you could be in the family. I wanted to drive that home because what it looks like about Joseph is that what he did was he functioned from this father that, oh, so loved him. And he knew it. He knew it. So watch what happens with Joseph's life. It says then in verse 4, and his brothers saw that his father loved him more than all of his brothers. And it says, this is their reaction. And so they hated him. And it says, they hated him. And mine's on the next page. And listen to this. They could not speak to him on friendly terms. That's pretty ticked off, isn't it? When you are so livid that your mouth is just ripe with hatred that you cannot even speak to this kid without ripping him up and down. That's pretty mad. Says they couldn't even say one friendly term to the little brother. And they saw something. They saw that dad loved him special. And they saw that he spoke truth, that his dad asked, What happened out there in the field? And he just spoke the truth. There's a progression of hate or of sin, isn't there? It starts with maybe a wound or a thought, and then if it's not taken care of, it grows into something a little bit bigger. And then if it's not taken care of at that point, it grows into something that starts to encompass your life. Now, we could say hate or we could say sin in general. Whatever that is, it starts to encompass your life. And pretty soon, your identity becomes that hate or that sin that hasn't been taken care of. Pretty soon, you become that. There's a scripture that says, I'm not finding it here, but maybe a truth here that says, hate separates, but love unifies. Think about that for a minute. It does, doesn't it? And this is what's happening to the brothers. They are so angry at him, they can't even speak friendly terms. And they're causing a division between him and them. In 1 John 4:20, it says, how can you say you love God when you hate your brother? It can't happen. It can't happen. In verse 5, something else Joseph does that causes the brothers to become more angry. And he starts to talk about a dream that he had. And this is where the R comes in on your page. And we're going to talk about the word rule or ruler. Because this is what happens. Joseph, who again is speaking truth out of love, he has no reason for fear. He knows this amazing love of his father. And it says in verse 5, then Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and it says they hated him even more. And this is what the dream was. He said, please listen to the dream I've had. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and my sheaf rose up and stood up, and yours gathered around and bowed down to my sheaf. Then the brothers said to him, they interpreted it, and they said to him, are you actually going to rule or to reign over us, or are you really going to rule over us? And it says again, so they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. So Joseph speaks out this, and it's true. God had given him this dream, and there's a plan. Remember when I said we first started talking about Joseph at 17, and it seems like God began to minister a plan in his life. Well, here's Joseph, and I wondered why, if he knew his brothers were so angry at him, why did he do this to cause even more anger? Why didn't he, let's see, how could he have said, you know, we were talking about even this morning, maybe he could have said it differently. Maybe he could have chose a better time. Well, I don't know, when somebody's ticked off at you, I don't know if you can find a better time or a better way. But here's Joseph, almost like he doesn't even know that they hate him so much. Oh, they're my brothers, you know, my dad loves me. And hey, brothers, I had this dream. Here's the dream. What did you think of that? I said, man, we hate you, little brother. You think we're going to bow down to you? I just told you my dream. That's my dream. That's what I had. I don't even know if Joseph knew the whole plan, that one day he would be used by God to save his family from perishing. All he knew is he had a dream. And I think sometimes with you and me, we're going through life and we don't completely, well, how can we, understand everything that's going on and why things are happening. But coming from a God that oh so loved us, we can think and we can know that he has a plan being worked out, that at this point in my life, this trial or whatever I'm going through right now, there's something bigger going on. So as we look back on Joseph's life, it's kind of a confidence builder that God is in control, because he is going to use Joseph in a powerful way. And one day his brothers, for their life, they're going to bow before him and he's going to save them. Wow. Wow. So Jesus one day stood up and he calls out to the people and he says, come to me, all who are thirsty, and I will give you water that springs up to it. Come to me. And I'm sure that people were going, what is that all about? What is he talking about? Who does he think he is? Then one time, Jesus heals a paralyzed man. And he says, your sins are forgiven. Stand up and walk. And the Pharisee says, wait a minute. Nobody can forgive sins except for God. So they were saying, who do you think you are? And Jesus says, well, I'm going to prove my point. Stand up and walk. And he stood up and walked. They became angry at Jesus because Jesus was, in fact, saying he was God, the Messiah right there. Turn over to Colossians chapter 1. So New Testament, where keep your finger in Genesis, Colossians chapter 1. So let's see. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, getting close. If you hit Philippians, your next is Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. Listen to this. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. And the Apostle Paul gives us a clear view of who Jesus is. Jesus is God. Jesus is Creator God. It says, for he, that's Jesus, delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption for the forgiveness of sins. And he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself might come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven, Jesus. The Savior of the world. Joseph would end up being the Savior of his family. Back to Genesis 37. We talked about this acrostic true. The first one we said time. We see how God steps into time at Joseph at 17. The next one we step into is to rule. And we see that God has a plan to rule through Joseph for the saving of his family. Just want to stop here for just a second. How are you under rule? How do you behave? What is your talk under authority? Sometimes we don't get it. And I'm sure his brothers didn't get what was going to happen. But what is your attitude when you know you're under somebody's authority? What is, when somebody tells you something to do, what is your attitude? What carries you? Now, because most of you read the life of Joseph, you're going to see that even Joseph's attitude when he was sent to jail, when he was in jail, he made the best of what he was doing. His attitude, what the jailer put him in charge because he was taking care of the prisoners. And even before that, Potiphar, he was in charge of all of Potiphar's stuff, that there wasn't anything that he didn't have charge of. That his attitude about being under authority and to be able to function and as a servant and do what your master tells you to do. No crying and no complaining, just doing. Now, the reason I bring that up is that Joseph is being trained by God himself. Before Joseph gets to the point of being second in charge of all of Egypt, and he would end up saving his family, God had him come through a training trench. Hard times. God had his hand. The Bible says that God's hand was on Joseph, and the people knew it. That God was training him to get to a point where he would use him in an amazing way. So I say that to say to you and to me, since you have started this journey with God, he's been training you through trials and through good times, because on the other side, there is someone, maybe more than someone, that needs to hear from you, that you are going to be ending up being maybe like the door that invites somebody into the kingdom of God. That he's been training you so that you would be an inviter into God's kingdom. You would be inviting people into God's kingdom by the way that you've been trained by God through the hard times to trust him, to know that kind of love, that the reason you exist is for his honor and his glory, and to invite as many people into his kingdom as possible. Isn't that amazing? Now, I wish that I would have learned some lessons years ago, because I think I would have been farther along. You know what I mean? It's like, ah, man, why did I have to keep going around that bush and learning that same lesson before I get off that merry-go-round and, you know? But his attitude was one of serving and of trusting, and somehow way back here, that love of his father had permeated through his life in order for him to do the truth, to be doing what is right, even in his suffering, to doing what is right. So Genesis 37, we said T for time, we said R for rule, and we've got two more, the U, and watch what happens next. In verse 9, it says, he had another dream. And he wouldn't be quiet about yet another dream. Joseph, what are you thinking? Oh, man. So he still had another dream, and he related to his brothers. Verse 9 of Genesis 37. He says, I have another dream, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. And he related it to his father and his brothers. And his father rebuked him and said to him, what is this dream you have had? Shall I and your mother and your brothers actually come to bow ourselves down before you to the ground? Verse 11 says, and his brothers were jealous of him, but, listen to this, his father kept the saying in mind. He was wondering, what is this all about? Maybe he's not just saying something that is so abstract and doesn't make sense. Maybe there's something going on here. He's thinking about it. Do you remember when Jesus was born and the shepherds came and they bowed down to worship? And the Bible says, and Mary kept all these things in her heart. She knew what Jesus was about, but she kept all these things in her heart. So I put the U as universe. So down on your page, the U is universe. And the reason why is because he talks about the sun and the moon and all the universe. And I'd like you to go to Matthew chapter 24, where Jesus talks about a time in the future where all heaven is gonna break open. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, pick up in verse 29. It says, but immediately after the tribulation, those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds in the sky with the power and great glory. And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. Jesus is going to gather and to save all those who have believed in him, all those who have trusted the truth about who Jesus is, that there's a day coming. And then the E is for eternity. All eternity, that he's gonna reign forever and ever. So what happened? What happened so far in Joseph's life? So far we see this child that's born from a mom that couldn't bear children, and after 20 years, here he is. We see nothing, and then at 17 years old, at this time, God starts to move in Joseph's life, and Joseph begins truthing. He begins just speaking truth. He lives for truth, and he just speaks the truth. He spoke the bad things that the brothers did, and then he spoke these dreams of truth. Then we see the brothers becoming angry over who he is and who does he think he is. And then we see even the father, his father, begin to wonder, what is this all about? The rest of the story is that Joseph ends up saving not only his family, but all of Egypt. That Joseph is the one that God uses to bless all of these people. So then we see you and I, where do we fit in this whole thing? Here we are sitting at Evergreen Church, and our journey with following Christ started somewhere else, probably, for most. And we're here at this intersection right now, today. At this intersection, he's pulled us together for maybe a long time, maybe just a brief time before he calls us to another place. But what about now? What about now? The decisions that you and I make have got to come from this place that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life, that God so loves you, and he's got a plan for your life to reach people around you. Paul said, when you are tracking with God, he says, without love, nothing else matters. Whatever you're doing has to permeate from a God that loves you in order for you to love people around you. How do we know the kingdom of God? How do we know that we're fulfilling God's plan for our life that Joseph doesn't know yet? How do we know that? It's by the way that we love one another, the way that we treat one another. It all boils down to that. Over and over again, Jesus condenses that love God and love people. If you're not doing this, you need to regroup. So what does that look like to love people? The best way that I can love Natalie is to be tight with God, right? Because even if I make sure I hit all the holidays and I do all that stuff, and for years I didn't, she told me, you're at ground zero if you hit all the holidays and you bring me flowers. You're at ground zero. Steve, you haven't been at ground zero yet. You've been in, you know, wake up, okay? Now, if you do something beyond that, now you're making progress here. But in order for me to make right moves, the best way that I can love Natalie is to love God. That's the equation for all of us, is the best way that we can love people is to make sure that we're loving God. And at times, that love may be keeping your mouth quiet. You know, there's times to help people by being critical and saying, hey, maybe you should pick up that fork. Maybe there's a time you just, you know, maybe love is just, would you just quit nitpicking? Would you just leave it? Give it a rest, okay? So as you go through your week this week, just a reminder that it's God that needs to love people around you. You can only fake it for so long, right? It all comes back to, like Joseph, where's that? The motivating factor of his life comes from a dad that oh so loved him. Our motivating factor is from a God that oh so loves us. And we got to live in that love in order to love others. Okay? So this week, look for ways to be that inviter, that lover of people, to invite them into the kingdom, to help them live in the kingdom. If I were to say to you, kingdom of heaven looks like this, what comes into your mind? When you're in the kingdom of heaven, now I'm not talking about in heaven, that's an amazing place, but in the kingdom of heaven here and now, what does that look like when you step into the kingdom? You say, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Jesus said, when people really understand what I'm talking about, the kingdom of heaven is like this. It's like a man who found a treasure in a field, and he went and sold everything he had to buy that land with that treasure. And he said, well, wait a minute, the kingdom of heaven is like this. In order to really understand and be in the kingdom of heaven, it's like a man who found a pearl of great price, and he sold all he had to buy that pearl. So what is Jesus saying? Jesus is saying, I want all of you. I want all of your heart. In my kingdom, you are all in. You're not just halfway in. You know, I'm in the world and I got half, you know, okay, I can, or I know I'm going to appease God. You know, I know I'm not all in with God. I know I'm not really there, but you know what I do? I'm going to give money to the guy on the corner, and God will see that, and that'll appease my sin. That'll appease my not being all in with God. Isn't that amazing to think that there are religions that think that you can appease God by just make sure you do this, and here's seven things, and make sure you do these things to appease God, but God's really saying, I don't want all that stuff. What I want is all of you. I want all of your heart. Now you're understanding the kingdom. I want all of you, because from that place right there, you're going to infect the world for me. You're going to be inviting people into the kingdom. So as I pray today, if you're desiring and you haven't really been all in, there hasn't been a time where you finally said, okay, all right, I'm all in. I'm going to ask that you would confess that even today. Pastor Steve has been preaching about this entrance into the kingdom by ABC, saying, admit that you've sinned, believe in what Jesus did on the cross, and confess him as your Lord, as your boss, that you're all in. Confess him right there. If you haven't done that, today is the day. Now, maybe for most of you, you've done that, and every single day, you're hit right in the face with, I know this is where it is. I know, okay, today, Lord, take me again. I'm all in. I'm confessing. I'm wanting to be all in, Lord. Please take me. That's called repentance. That's called saying, all right. But that's the secret of life for us from here to eternity, is with your whole heart, your motives and everything, with your whole heart. That's what he wants. He doesn't want appeasing things. But, well, I'll go to church and that'll appease God, but I won't give him all my life. I know I'll do. No, he wants all of us.